Spring 1981. I was living in an apartment in Arlington, Virginia, which is right over the D.C. line. I walked to work every day, which was an ice cream store at the time. I was the store manager, and I was there 40 to 60 hours a week. I made the deposit, I hired, I fired, I did the inventory, I did ice cream scooping, the works. I was in a band at the time, nothing much musically speaking, just four of us with fucked up equipment, but we had fun playing and practicing. A guy named Mitch Parker gave my friend Ian Mackay and I a copy of Black Flag's Nervous Breakdown EP. We played it all the time. For me, the record's cover said it all. It was a man baring his fists with his back to a wall. In front of him, another man fending him off with a chair. I felt like that guy with his fists up every day of my life. Black Flag soon became my favorite band. Stories of their shows in Los Angeles were legend by the time they reached the East Coast. They had their own record company called SST. They took no shit. Ian called SST and talked to Black Flag's bass player, Chuck Dukowski. Chuck told Ian about the tour coming up and gave him the dates for the East Coast. Black Flag had dates booked for New York and D.C. We were going to go get to see the mighty Black Flag. A group of us went up to New York City to see the band play because we couldn't wait to see them in D.C., and we figured the more we saw them, the better. So we drove up to New York City and saw them at the Peppermint Lounge. I will never forget when they walked out on stage, how excited I was. Chuck Dukowski was out there walking in circles, pounding his bass and making all this fucked up noise and screaming at the crowd. They hadn't even started playing yet and it was already a trip. I think they opened with the song, "I've Heard It Before." The place exploded. All the songs were abrupt and crushing. Short bursts of unbelievable intensity. I never saw anyone play like that before. It was like they were trying to break themselves into pieces with the music. It was one of the most powerful things I've ever seen. There was not a second wasted on stage. The songs were devoid of filler. The urgency of the music and the playing was unsettling. It made me wonder what planet they came from. I wanted to move there immediately. After the show, we hung out with the band for a little while and they were really cool to us. It meant a lot. I respected and liked them. A few days later, they came down to D.C. to play at the 9:30 Club. Again, they were good and the place went off when they played. I liked the D.C. show better because they played two sets and I got to hear all the songs. They stayed at Ian's house after the show and they left the next morning. I remember watching their van pull away up the street and wanting to be in it. It was amazing to me how they pulled in, played, hung out with all the locals, and then took off to the next adventure. I had to hurry up to get to work. As I walked down the hill towards a long night at the workplace, I started getting depressed. Black Flag was a bunch of guys who were out there winging it and trying to do something with their lives. They had no fixed income and they lived like dogs, but they were living life a lot more fully than I was by a long shot. I had a steady income and an apartment and money in the bank, but I also had a job where I got yelled at when things didn't go right. I had to be there all the time. I saw the same streets and the same people every day. My job took over a lot of my waking hours. After I hung out with the Flag guys, I saw that there was a lot more out there to be seen and done, and I didn't think I was ever going to do any of it. That night at work, everything in my life felt meaningless. I knew that somehow I was blowing it. I had a low-level panic attack. I got a glimpse of something that made it impossible to bullshit myself any longer. I wished it didn't open my eyes so much and make me see so clearly. I saw my life stretching out in front of me. Same town, same people, same everything. It felt as if I was getting tied down and beaten by life. They had guts. The way they were living went against all the things I had been raised to believe in were right. If I had listened to my father, I would have joined the Navy, served, and gone into the straight world without a whimper. I'm not putting that down, but it's not the life for everyone. Chuck Dukowski had given me a demo tape of unreleased Black Flag music. Every morning before I would go into work, I would play that tape. Damaged One, Police Story, No More, and their version of Louie Louie. I loved and hated that tape. I loved it because the tunes were great and the words said what I was feeling. I hated it because I wanted to be the singer. Des Cadena, who was the singer at the time, was great, but still I could imagine myself up there doing it. Black Flag came east again in June. They played in New York on June 27th at the Irving Plaza. The Bad Brains and UXA played as well. There's no shows booked in D.C., so I went up to see them. I got up there pretty early and met up with Chuck and Greg. I hung out most of the afternoon with them. That night, they were great. After the show, the band went down the street to 7A, a small club, to play for free. I went along. The sun was coming up and I had to be at work in 6 hours. I had a 5-hour drive. Time to leave. I went up to the stage and asked them to play a song called Clocked In to send me on my way. Des said, "This is called Clocked In. It's for Hank because he's got to go to work now." The band laid into the song. I got on stage and took the microphone and sang. I don't know what compelled me to do that. Sure was fun, and Des didn't seem to mind. I left the club to drive home. I went right into work with no sleep. I didn't need it. I was still pumped from singing with Black Flag. The fact that I'd been on stage and had a taste of what it was like to be in the band was good enough for me. Days later, I'm working at the store and I get a call. It's Des. The band is still up in New York taking a few days off, and they want to know if I want to come up there and jam. I don't understand what they mean, but it's the flag talking, so I hop to it. I went back to my apartment and called Ian and explained that I thought I was being asked to audition for Black Flag. After that, my roommate came in and asked what was going on, and I told him that I had to go to New York because I might be asked to join Black Flag. He thought I was talking some shit. It sure sounded like a load. I walked all the way to the train station because I didn't feel like getting a cab. It was a long walk and it was a good chance to think about the whole thing. I thought it best not to get my hopes up. I got on an early train and fell asleep. The next morning, we all meet at Odessa's, a restaurant down in the East Village, and I ask him what the deal is. Greg tells me that Des wants to play guitar, and they're looking for a singer since Des is moving over to rhythm, but I want to try out. I hardly knew how to answer. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. We went to Mikasa Rehearsal Studios and set up. All of a sudden, I'm standing there in front of them with a mic in my hand. Greg asked me what song I wanted to play first. I thought I must be dreaming. For a second, I didn't think I was there at all. I told him, Police Story. It was like I dropped a coin into some kind of video game. The entire band kind of reared back and lurched forward, and I heard the classic Gin feedback, and all of a sudden, we were into the song. We played all their material. What words I knew, I sang. The ones I didn't, I made up. We did 2 sets. At the end, we all kind of looked at each other. The band went out and back to talk it over, and I sat on the floor of the practice room and waited it out. They came back in, and Chuck said, Well? I said, Well, what? He said, Are you going to join or not? I was in. That's pretty much how I joined Black Flag. I took the train back to D.C. and spent the trip looking over the lyrics that the band had given me to start learning. It was all the material that would later comprise the Damaged album. Padded Cell, Damaged 2, Room 13, all of it. It was heavy stuff. I became so absorbed, I barely noticed when we hit D.C. A couple of days later, I packed up, quit my job, sold my car, sublet my apartment, and left Washington. I had no idea what was going to happen, but this is what I wanted, so off I went. It was great telling my boss that I was quitting. He offered me more money. I told him it wasn't a money issue. I told him I was off to do this thing, and I didn't know how it was going to work out, but I had to go for it. He told me it was a crazy idea and I should get back to work. He laid into me hard, and it got to me a little. Luckily for me, Ian Mackay was really behind me and told me he knew this was going to be great and to go for it. I respected everything he said, and I still do to this day. He gave me the extra shove out the door that I needed. For me, it was the chance to live. I left my hometown like a guy making a jailbreak. Ian took me to the Greyhound station and wished me good luck. I caught up with Black Flag in Detroit. Des wanted to finish the tour on vocals, and there was no way I was ready. I worked the stage and sometimes did the encores. Soundcheck was used to teach me the songs and to come up with rhythm guitar parts for Des to play. I think we played Chicago, Minneapolis, and Salt Lake City before we hit LA. The Chicago show was intense. The effigies opened and they were great. Flag went on next. A few songs into the set, a girl was getting roughed up by one of the bouncers. The guys in this place were really out of line. Chuck knocked the guy in the head with the end of his bass. The guy starts bleeding. He gets taken to the hospital to get stitches. After the show, we're packing the gear out and we can't find some of the drums. The drums are big, so it's not as if they got misplaced. We knew something was up. One of the shithead bouncers came out and asked us if we wanted the drums back. Mugger and I went into the manager's office and the kick drum is sitting on a desk. The guy who ran the place was sitting there, surrounded by bouncers, and he started giving a shit about what fuck-ups we were and all this other bullshit. I have no idea how we managed to get the gear out of there and not get our asses kicked, but we did. We found out later that the club owner called ahead of our other shows and told him that we were bad people and to not pay us. This was a normal thing back in those days. The show in Salt Lake was interesting. I met a kid who was cuffed to the handle of a police car outside the gig. He was there early to catch soundcheck, and the cop busted him drinking a beer in the parking lot. I hung out with the guy and gave him some water. It was strange to be talking to this guy who was standing in the sun tied to a car. I guess the pig figured he was teaching him a lesson. That taught me plenty. We got to L.A. days later and we had nowhere to stay. The old SST had been shut down by the cops. Black Flag was told to leave Torrance, California, or else. Eventually, we found a space to live on Santa Monica Boulevard. It was an office space above the studio where we later recorded the Damaged album. We all slept on the floor. We got a practice space in the same building and could get more space for sleep. On several nights, you could look out the window to the parking lot and see an unmarked police car. They were watching us. I remember that really scaring me. One morning we came out and all the doors of the van were open and nothing was missing. I wondered if it was the pigs fucking with us. It was at this time that it became my understanding that the police were fucked. At one point, a woman in the neighborhood called the police and told them that one of us had tried to rob her with a shotgun. That's all we needed. I was learning a lot of things fast. Everything was different. Just a few weeks before, I was working a straight job and money and food weren't a problem. Now the next meal was not always a thing you could count on. Money was hard to come by. It was a lot to get used to, but it was great. At that point, I didn't really feel fully integrated into the band. At times, I felt like I was a visitor. The way we were living was foreign to me. Slowly, I came to realize that this was it, and there's no place I'd rather be. As much as it all sucked for all of us to be living on the floor on top of each other, it was still better than the job I had left in D.C. In the next 5 years, I was to learn what hard work was all about. Black Flag and SST was on a work ethic that I had never before experienced and have never seen since. Greg, Chuck, and the faithful roadie Mugger were the hardest working people I have ever seen. They went into whatever it was we had to do without questioning the time it took, the lack of sleep or food. They just went for it. No one had time for anyone else's complaining. If you ever made a noise about it, Mugger would just start laughing in your face and tell you that this wasn't Van Halen. The following is what I remember from the tour dates around this time. Huntington Beach, California, August 1981, The Cuckoo's Nest. After all the weeks of practice, I felt ready to play. It was interesting to hang out in the club and walk amongst the audience. None of them knew what the new singer in the band looked like yet. Later on, a few girls had found out that I was that guy and started talking to me. This was a new experience. I was not used to women even giving me the time of day. Eventually, the conversation came to the bottom line of what they really wanted. Guest list for their friends stranded outside. After the opening bands played, we hit stage like a bomb. All these crazy motherfuckers were up front yelling at me that I'd better be good or they were gonna kick my ass. I think we opened with Revenge, and the place exploded. It was that kind of music. Greg and Chuck had created the ultimate soundtrack for a full-scale riot. This era of the band was like nothing before or since. No band made people react like that. I had seen the Circle Jerks make some people lose their shit, but not like the Flag. Every song was the most direct line to what the fuck it was all about. In my opinion, the finest Black Flag record released is the First 4 Years compilation. It's all the singles and compilation cuts that the band made before I joined. The record spans 3 singers that came before me. It's 34 minutes, and it's about 3 full-length albums worth of anyone else's music. It is the densest batch of jams I have ever heard on one record besides the Funhouse album by the Stooges. When you put it up against what's out there today, it's hilarious. These bands would have been eaten alive at a Black Flag show. Music is mellowed out to the point where most of it just doesn't interest me anymore. And I'm not a snob either, I just can't forget what I know. Anyway, the gig was great and the crowd liked me enough that they didn't beat the shit out of me. August 22nd, Boston, Massachusetts. Flew out and played. My first time at a club called The Channel. Didn't sleep and flew right back to L.A. First time I met Mitch Burry, who proved to be one of the longest-standing friendships I have sustained. He gets better with age. San Diego, California. This was a great show. Play the first few songs and see this girl trying to grab me. I move away from her. Her boyfriend and his 2 friends are apparently on angel dust and see this as a great opportunity to drag me off stage and beat the shit out of me. It was funny. I was held down as this guy kept bashing me in the face. I yelled for Mugger between fists. Eventually, the guy was pulled off me. I finished the set and then went to the men's room to straighten out my nose. I did a pretty good job. It only goes slightly to the right. The best part was the ride to the gig. We were stuck in a traffic jam near San Diego and we'd been cut off by a woman driving this large car. Mugger had had enough of her bullshit and hopped out of the van and dumped his yogurt through her window. Of course, we got busted and Greg had to do all the talking. I don't know how we got out of it, but we did. San Diego is a tough town. September 1981. The 11th, Devonshire Downs, California. I thought I'd worked my ass off before doing minimum wage. For this show, we put up flyers for days on end. We'd start in the morning, and we wouldn't finish till sundown. One day, Greg and I went out to put up flyers on telephone poles around La Cienega and Sunset Boulevard. We were across the street from the 7-Eleven on La Cienega between Santa Monica and Sunset. Greg was telling me about the pigs in the area and how the last thing you wanted was to get caught. Right after he said that, a cop car pulled up and we were nailed. The pig gave us so much shit, screamed in our face and called us a bunch of names. For some reason, he let us go. I ended up going out on flyer patrol with Mugger every day. We would make a combination of white glue and wheat paste. One guy on lookout, one guy slapping up the paste. One layer on the pole, put the flyer on, another coat of paste. After that, all you had to do was let the sun do the work. These flyers would stay up to a year. You couldn't get them off. We would pick a main street and put up flyers for miles. We went to UCLA, the Valley, everywhere. And this was just for one gig. One day we were putting up flyers in Hollywood and we walked through a supermarket parking lot. We saw this guy putting his groceries into a gray Mercedes. Someone had spray painted a big swastika on the guy's hood. I just kind of stared at it. Mugger went off and started laughing his ass off. The man shook his fist at us and drove away. At that moment, I understood what he saw. Mugger and I had no hair on our heads. He probably thought we were fascist skinheads getting off on the artwork. I learned a lot from Mugger at this time. We went flyering up around Westwood, and we were hungry all the time and never had much money besides bus fare. We went to a Carl's Jr. and each got a small salad plate. The place had one of those deals where you get to fill up the plate, but you don't get to go back for seconds. I followed Mugger's lead. He put the plate on the tray and proceeded to make the entire tray his salad plate. It was a mountain of food. Awesome. I did the same. The manager saw us and didn't like it, but I could see immediately that he wasn't going to do shit about it. We were too fucked up looking. Covered with paste and dirt, we were sunburnt, we had no hair, we looked crazy. Our bucket of paste and backpack of supplies on the floor? Forget it, not worth it. I learned that you can get away with a lot of shit if you look like it's all you know how to do. Mugger told me about the times he was living on the streets and he was reduced to eating dog food out of cans put on white bread. He said you balled it up and ate it fast as you could and tried not to taste it. All this was new to me. Finally, the gig came. I hoped all the flyering was worth it. It was a great bill. Fear, The Stains, and Black Flag. I can't remember who was on stage at the time, but at one point someone shot tear gas or mace into the crowd. People were on the ground holding their faces and screaming. I carried a few people to the bathroom and got them under the sink. Finally, we got to play. A few songs in, I looked out and saw this brown shape in front of me. I was thinking to myself, how strange it looked, and what was it doing suspended in the air like that? A 1-quart Budweiser bottle bounced off my hand and went under the drum riser. Tough crowd. The PA company normally did country and western gigs. There was no way they were ready for this audience. I broke one mic and went to get another one. The PA man gave me this look. A kid landed on one of the monitors and stomped on it on his way off stage. The PA man came out and started yelling at the crowd and looking over his monitor. He was immediately showered in oaths, spit, and cups. He looked at me and said he was going to turn off the PA. Choke told him that his PA would be destroyed and he would get his ass kicked by the crowd if he did it. All of this was true. He looked at us and called us every name in the book and went back behind the monitor board and remained there glaring at us for the rest of the gig. October, San Diego, California. I'm not exactly sure, but I think this one was a bust. I think we got a few songs done before the pigs came busting in. It was one of those nights where they say they're going to impound the equipment. I grew to hate police quickly. All the bullshit they got up to was so out of line. They did what they wanted to with punk rockers. They did stuff at our shows that they could have gone to jail for. It was an eye-opening experience for me. I grew up in a neighborhood where pigs went after the bad guys, not kids standing there with their hands on their head saying, "I'm not resisting you," over and over again. These pigs called these kids every name in the book and beat the shit out of them. I understood that I had no rights and whatever went down was going to be up to the pig in charge. The California pigs would come on so hard and heavy, it was like being lorded over by a child twice your body weight. It was always funny when the pig would take the mic from me and start talking. I would have to stand next to him and watch the crowd bum out. 10th and the 11th, San Francisco, California. It was the first time I played the famous Mabuhay Gardens. I'd been there before with the Teen Idols there in 1980. I'll never forget that. We went there to see a show on a night we weren't playing. Great bill, Circle Jerks before they had a record out, followed by Flipper and then the Dead Kennedys. The place was packed. The crowds in San Francisco were not violent in those times like down in LA and the beaches. They were not ready for the guys the Jerks brought with them. Some of Huntington Beach's hardest. As soon as the Jerks started playing, the Huntington Beach boys took over the entire place. They got into an altercation with the bouncers and beat the shit out of them. I have never seen anything like it. For some reason, they liked us DC guys, which was a good thing. We hung out with them for a few days and had our minds blown minute to minute by the intensity of these guys. I have never seen so much violence entertained by such a small group of people in my life. A few days after our first encounter with them, the Teen Idols played the Mabuhay. They all showed up and soon there was blood and fights. One of the HBs got sliced open by a guy wielding a broken bottle. The guy got dismantled. The most vivid memory I have is of them getting on a public bus. Us DC guys paid and sat down. The HBs all filed past the driver. The last HB in line got out a nickel and put it in the box and sat down. When the driver asked about the rest of the money, one of them said, "We're students." The driver wisely didn't do shit. The HBs terrorized everyone on the bus. Anyone who looked their way got spat at. Like I said, I never saw anything like those guys in my life. The best part about playing the Mab was the guy who ran the place. His name was Dirk Dirksen. He was a real character. He would insult you on the way in, and between bands, we'd get on stage and rip on the crowd and the band that was just about to go on and the band that just went off. He would crack people up. He was a good friend of Black Flags and was always cool to us. He later ran a club on top of the Mab called the On Broadway. We played a lot of shows there. Thinking about it now, the backstage of the On Broadway was where I spoke with Will Shatter from Flipper for the last time. He was on something and talking really slowly, a few inches from my face. "Have a really, really good show. Have a beautiful show." He knew he was tripping me out, and he was liking it. I remember the first set at the Mab. I jumped off the stage and bounced off the piano and landed hard on some guy and pinned him to the floor. I looked down. It was Jello Biafra. "Sorry about that, Chief." Huntington Beach, California. This was great. Dukowski's walking back from a hamburger place across the street from the club. He jaywalks and gets hassled by the police. They run a warrant check on him and find out that he has an outstanding parking ticket or some shit, so they take him away. Greg and I go down to pay the ticket and get him out so we can play. At the front desk of the police station, we were asking about getting Chuck out. They ran warrant checks on both me and Greg. They nailed Greg on an outstanding ticket. I had to drive the van back to the club and borrow money from Jerry, the owner. I drove back to the police station with Robo when I paid the tickets and the guys were released and we got to play. We opened the set with Police Story. We were supposed to play a show at the Briner Hall in San Jose on October 23rd. We loaded up the van and got about as far as the Grapevine, which is a stretch of road outside of LA. The van made a bad sound and the engine just kind of melted. We pushed it backwards down the highway and into a truck stop. We were there most of the night. The promoter drove down from San Jose to pick us up even though we had missed the show. Most of the band went home. Margaret and I went up with the equipment. We did the drive in the back of the pickup truck. It was so cold. By the time we got to San Jose hours later, we were stiff. We crashed at someone's house and I don't remember what we did the next day. This is the great part. We tried to play the same hall again on the 29th. We loaded in and soundchecked. We felt good that we were going to be able to make the date up and not look like idiots. After soundcheck, Greg, Chuck, and I drove to San Francisco to do a radio interview at some station that I don't remember. We would go to any length to do press. The interview was a waste of time. Most of the press stuff that we did at this time was. We started driving back to the venue to play, and the van ran out of gas several miles from San Jose in the middle of nowhere. Greg had to run a few miles to find a gas station to make a call. Getting gas was not an option. We had no money. Greg managed to contact the promoter. He came with a gas can. We finally got to the gig, and we see a bunch of people standing around outside. The pigs had shut down the show. I remember seeing Dez looking at us with total disgust. People were coming up to us saying that we sucked. I couldn't disagree. October 31st, San Francisco. Mugger and I went into San Francisco early to put up flyers for this show. We were on the scam from day one. I learned a lot. I was asking him stupid questions like, where are we going to sleep and when do we eat? He laughed at me and told me that we were just going to have to make it up as we went along. We stood in front of the Mubuhay Gardens after a day of putting up flyers and got some money from some friends of muggers who were selling fake joints out on the street. We met some guy who had seen us play before in San Francisco, and he said he would put us up at his parents' house, but they couldn't find out. We went there and the parents were actually in the house and we had to sneak in around them. The next day we were back out there on flyer patrol. We saw Jello Biafra in a restaurant. We went in and sat down at his table and immediately started eating his food. He didn't seem to mind. I did my part by going back and talking to the waitress, telling her that we were here early to put up flyers and we had no money and could she please help us out, even though we looked filthy and crazy. She gave us some food and I put her on the guest list. We did this kind of thing for a couple more days until the rest of the band showed up. I think the show got shut down by the police halfway through anyway. In the fall of 1981, we recorded the Damaged album. The guys did the songs without me and I did the vocals later on. It was amazing to watch Greg Ginn in the studio. He was relentless. So much energy. He would tape the headphones to his head for overdubs so they couldn't fly off. Robo always wore these bracelets on his left wrist and the drum mics would pick them up. It became part of the sound. You can hear it on the album. Chuck and Greg coached me on the vocals. I needed all the help I could get. I would sing as hard as I could every single time. I didn't know anything about pacing myself. Chuck walked me through the breakdown section of the song What I See because I couldn't come up with anything to improv. It must have been funny to see me work so hard instead of working smart. We did a version of Louie Louie that was never used. The guys did a strange jam at the end of it until the tape ran out. I heard it back once and never heard it again. I don't think it was even mixed down. I did the vocal for Damaged One in two takes. It was just me winging it like I did it live. After the second take, Spot told me the first one was the keeper and I was finished. We did the record fairly quickly. I remember the vocals for TV Party taking a long time because there were so many parts to do. It was fun to work with Spot at this time. Spot was the band's producer and sound man. He produced several records for SST. He was one of a kind. He would go in and play Greg's guitar so Greg could hear it at the mixing board. He could play any Black Flag song, no problem. I never thought Spot liked me. I got that feeling as soon as I joined the band. I had a feeling that I was intruding on some imagined territory. It was just bullshit. Years later, I wrote him and asked him what was up, and he wrote me back and told me that in his opinion, I had ruined the band. Whatever. Listening back to the records he produced, I think he ruined them, but it doesn't really matter at this point. It was the best time I ever had doing a Black Flag album. The rest were hard to get through for a number of reasons. Financial stress was a 24-hour-a-day reality for the band. We were up against it for the entire time the band was together. There was never any sellout or any rock star bullshit. People would sometimes talk that shit, and it was always so funny to us. Soon after the recording was done, we set out on our first tour with me on vocals. It was amazing. A few months before, I was working behind the counter at a straight job, and now I was hitting the road with the baddest band in the land. What follows is what I remember from the dates. November, Tucson, Arizona. I think we played this small bar that we ended up playing a few times over the years. It eventually burned down. One time we were there playing away, and there were all these filthy guys in trench coats on Dez's side going off. Dez had put all the local bums outside the club on the guest list. Dez was always into this great music and turned me on to a lot of stuff that I still play to this day. I first heard the Pink Fairies song Do It from Dez. He was the one who turned me on to Hawkwind, Lightning Hopkins, Mountain, and all kinds of good stuff. Phoenix, Arizona. For the first few visits to Phoenix, we played this place called the Madison Square Gardens. It was an old boxing and wrestling ring, really small. It had a chain-link fence up at the front of the stage, which was pretty strange. We played there with this really weak band who had a singer named Frank Discussion. They're playing their set before us, and at one point, Frank pulls out a lab rat and a hammer and tells the crowd that he's going to kill the rat with a hammer if someone doesn't stop him. People just stand there. I only heard a few of the last words of this sentence because I was backstage. I went running out to save the rat only in time to watch it get hammered into the stage floor. I thought it sucked. When he came backstage after the show, I threw the cage at his head. I don't think he ever understood why I was mad. San Francisco, California. We got to the MAB and I went to the dressing room and tried to find a place to sleep for a little while before soundcheck. I hear a Misfits song seeping in from the club upstairs. I figured that someone was playing a tape through the sound system. The song came to an end, and then I heard someone tuning up. Okay, some band playing a Misfits song at their sound check. The band played another Misfits song, and then another one. I walked up there to watch this band that seemed so bent on playing Misfits covers. I came in the door and looked at the stage. It was the Misfits. I didn't know they were playing that night. I only knew one person that had ever seen them play, as they only played on Halloween. I recognized Glenn Danzig immediately. It was amazing to hear them live after years of playing the singles endlessly. They all came up to the front of the stage and shook my hand. They were really cool. They asked me what song I wanted to hear, and I asked them to play Horror Business, and they did. Later on that night, they played their set. Luckily for me, they went on before we did, and I got to see the whole thing. They were great. Walking into the On Broadway in the late afternoon and encountering the Misfits will be something I'll never forget. On one of those early San Francisco trips, we went to Jello Biafra's wedding reception at Target Video. Some of the Flipper guys and some of the Flag guys got together on the Target stage and started playing. It was intense. I didn't have the guts to sing. I was scared of the Flipper guys. Ted Falcone, their bass player, that guy's heavy. They never relented, ever. I would try and talk to them, they'd always give me the Flipper treatment. I never knew if one of them was going to pull some shit. It's not as if they were rock stars or anything. They were just heavy. Heavier than you. Heavier than anything. They didn't care. That's just the way they were. I didn't mind. When they played, they were amazing. Riverside, California. This was one of Greg's bad equipment nights. He would have problems with his gear a lot. Amp smoking and shorting out. His shit started frying during the middle of the set on this night. He sat down on the stage with a soldering iron and started work while the rest of the band kept going. We were doing what we called the trudge riff at the time. It didn't have any lyrics. I looked over at Chuck for some advice as to what to do, and he said, "Just scream!" So I started screaming. Greg wrote some real lyrics to the song later on, and the song title was changed to Scream. December, Washington, D.C., two sets. The 9:30 Club. It was cool to play at the same club I had seen Black Flag in several months before. I learned something that night that has stuck with me. I got shit from some of the people I knew. They told me that I had become some kind of rock star. The fact that I left Washington, D.C. and come back in this big band was a sellout. Some people I had known for years treated me strange. It hurt at first, and then I realized something. You're going to do what you're going to do, and that's all there is to it. From that night on, I figured they can go get fucked. From then on, I treated D.C. like any other city on the tour. When I played there, I did the same thing that I did in the city the night before and the city the night after. I played my guts out and loaded the gear back into the van. Most of the people I knew were glad to see me, and that was good. I was very young and had a lot to learn about how people were and how the real world worked. I found out big time, often in large doses I might not have been ready for. I did the best I could. UK tour. After our gig in Washington, D.C., we set out for England. I had been there once with my mother several years before. I remember being very excited about going out of the country with a band. It was a great adventure for me. Ian came out with us. He wanted to check it out, so he bought himself a ticket, and off we went. Our first show was with The Damned at a place called the Lyceum. I was excited about this. The Damned were one of my favorite bands at the time. We loaded in the gear in the early afternoon. It was cold and the place smelled old. I was to learn soon enough that a lot of the places in England were cold, old, and stank. I don't remember what we did until gig time. I remember Captain Sensible of the Damned coming to our dressing room and telling us that he really liked our band a lot and he was looking forward to seeing us play. He was incredibly cool. I told him I had been listening to his band for years and it meant a lot to be playing with him. He told me that the audience would probably hate us, but not to worry about it. Just play. And everything would be okay. Half an hour before we went on, a man from Sounds Magazine came to interview us. I was flying around the room unable to sit still because I was so excited to be playing. We were going to go on first, then a band called the Anti-Nowhere League would play, and then the Damned would go on. When we were told it was gig time, I went running down the steep stairs toward the stage. I wasn't thinking about anything besides getting out there. I turned a corner on the steps and ran full on into Dave Vanian, the Damned singer. He was dressed to the hilt in his vampire gear. I nearly knocked him over. I felt like such a jerk. He was cool, though. He extended his hand and said hello. I was tripping out on that as I went down the rest of the stairs. a guy whose records I had listened to for years, and all I could do was nearly send him flying down a flight of stairs. Off to a great start. We hit stage, and I probably blew my voice out on the first song because I was going for it so hard. I remember finishing that last song and looking at the audience. They just stared at us blankly. They were much too cool to acknowledge us at all. I looked out at them with all their punk rock clothes and the haircuts 2 feet above their heads. I knew then that they were just a bunch of weak posers and I shouldn't take them seriously. The Anti-Nowhere League sucked. They were just stupid. They couldn't play and they made no bones about it. They did pose out though and the audience loved them. I thought they were weak. Ian and I were told that it wouldn't be a good idea if we went into the crowd when the Damned played, like we might get hurt or something. So we went way up in the nosebleed seats and watched them from there. They were great. After the show, we found a place to stay with these two American girls who were over there hanging out. We put the entire lot of us in their tiny single room. I don't know how they stood us, but they did and they saved our asses from the cold. We were miserable. There was not a lot of money for food and we were hungry and cold all the time. We all sat on the floor and watched Greg practice scales for hours. Time passed slowly and it was depressing as hell. It was the first time I had to deal with the downtime that comes with touring. It's the endless hours of nothing that can crush you harder than the rigors of playing. These two girls were friends of Jimmy Percy, singer with the legendary band Sham 69. They told us that we might be able to meet him if he had time. This didn't mean anything to the guys, but it meant a lot to Ian and myself. We had met him briefly years before when Sham played in New York. He was cool to us and we were into checking him out. They called him and he said we could come out and visit. All of us got on a train and went way out of London. I forget where we got out, but we didn't have any money, so we faked like we didn't know what the deal was and just bolted out of there. People from the station came out and nailed us. I think the girls had some money and paid our way. We took a cab out to his place, a small house in a wooded area. He remembered Ian and I. We played him tapes of all the new stuff coming out on SST like the Minutemen, Saccharine Trust, and the Stains. He didn't like any of it. He played us one of his solo albums and we thought it sucked. I don't think any of us told him that. We talked about all kinds of stuff and I forget what most of it was about because it was so tripped out. It started to occur to me that this guy had a screw loose. He insisted that we watch the movie Oh Lucky Man with him. Cool movie. After that, he asked us if we needed any clothes. He had this big suitcase that he opened up explaining that they were his tour clothes and he didn't need them anymore. He pulled out stuff and put it on the floor. All the guys took something because we really hadn't dressed correctly for the cold. He pulled out a pair of pants that I recognized from photos of him. He told me they were his sham pants or something. He wanted me to have them to carry on some cause or whatever. I took them. I eventually gave them to a guy named Mike Heath because they fit him. It was a strange night. For some strange reason, we were supposed to do dates with Bow Wow Wow and the Exploited. The next few days were spent spinning our wheels because Bow Wow Wow kept canceling. Finally, we got to play in Manchester. We spent all of our remaining dough on petrol to make the drive. So we get to Manchester Polytechnic and we find out that we're playing with this band called Chelsea, a well-known English punk rock band. For some reason, Black Flag was headlining. I smelled trouble immediately. We didn't even have an album out there yet, just the six-pack single. We were headlining? Someone, somewhere, was going to be really pissed off. We loaded in the equipment and went upstairs to the dressing room to try and find some food. The dressing room is huge and was to be used by all the bands on the bill that night. I fall asleep on the floor next to the wall, out of the way of everything and everyone. Fine. I'm woken up by a boot in my ribs. I grab my side and look up, and there's Gene October, the singer in Chelsea. "Excuse me, Los Angeles, sorry about that. I just tripped over you." "Yeah, right." I go back to sleep. I get woken up again by the same boot. "Oh, Los Angeles, so sorry." I remain cool, being the only flag member in the room, which is now full of Chelsea and crew. The prick. He starts talking to me. "You really don't have much good music in America, do you, Los Angeles? The Dickies and the Ramones, I mean, they are a load of shit, aren't they, Los Angeles?" What a drag. I had two Chelsea records at home. I just stare and nod my head. I was hoping that I would get to talk to the guy about all the bands he's played with over the years and what his band is up to, seeing as I'm a bit of a fan. It was hard to take. Hours later, Chelsea is on stage and old Gene is talking to the crowd between songs. "There's some short-haired hippies from Los Angeles in the crowd tonight. It's Black Flag, I want you to get them. The crowd cheers. Me and Ian walk into the crowd smiling and waving, saying, here we are, motherfuckers, come and get us. No one came and got us. Not one. Personally, I was kind of hoping one or five of them would have, so I could have had the pleasure of taking 9 days of misery out on one of their faces. Finally, we get to play. The kids in the crowd were really cool. I thought we were doing all right. This one boy kept spitting on me for the whole set, and I didn't do anything about it. I was trying to be cool with these people. The spitting thing was just too much for old Ian. He walked up and smacked the guy upside his head. After that, the entire audience took a few steps back. I apologize for Ian's actions, even though I thought what he did was right on. Now as I write this, I have to put down my pen because I'm laughing so hard. The look on that guy's face was worth the entire trip. Of course we had no place to stay, no blankets, nothing. We met these two girls and they agreed to put us up at their flat. They told us not to get our hopes up because they're on the dole. We get to the flat. I was expecting a hovel. It's a split-level apartment. The place is nicer than any place I've lived in since I lived with my mom. But no heat, no hot water, no food. I wiped the spit off my hair, face, and chest as best I could with a washcloth and went to sleep on the floor in my coat. I kept waking up because of the cold and damp. Finally, morning came. We drank all the hot tea that these girls would let us have, and then we got in the truck and left for the next show. We went to London and played at a place called The Rainbow. This was our first gig with The Exploited. I remember going into the dressing room and seeing one of the roadies from The Exploited walking out with our small box of food. He looked at us and told us to come and get it if we dared. None of us thought that was such a good idea. We went into the dressing room, and there was a newly punched out hole in the window, and the cold air was coming through big time. We stuffed some piece of clothing into the hole. We did get a sound check, though, and it didn't sound so bad in there. Honey Bane was the opening act, and she went out with a raincoat and an umbrella to protect herself from all the spit flying at the stage. Their bass player was the guy from the Lurkers, a favorite band of me and Ian's. I think we scared him a bit when we came up to him because we had no hair and we were all excited. He cooled out when we explained that we had all of his records. It was funny as hell to see Honey take that spit-covered raincoat off and say thank you goodnight and walk off stage without getting any spit on her. So finally, we go on. The Exploited fans are probably the most thick-headed, moronic, capable of kicking the shit out of you bunch I have ever encountered. They immediately started giving us the Nazi salute and waving their football scarves. I was beyond caring at this point. We just kept out of the way of the spit and did our thing. At one point, I accidentally elbowed Chuck in the head. I opened up a cut on his forehead that took 7 stitches to close. There was blood everywhere. I think this actually made the skinheads like us a little. In the next song, Chuck swung his bass around and one of the tuning pegs slashed into me, so now I was bleeding too. It was a blood festival. Chuck is pouring coke on his bass to get the blood off the strings, and we kept on playing like nothing happened. So we finished the set and Chuck goes off to the hospital to get stitched up. Ian and I go out and check out The Exploited and their singer, Waddy. They sucked. The skinheads knew every word and sang along. Finally, at the end of the set, Waddy told the crowd that the Jam's gig had just let out up the street and they should go up there and beat their fans up as they went to the tube. The band played their hit song, Fuck a Mod, and the skins tore out of that place. We later found out that they indeed caught up with the people coming home from the show and beat some of them up pretty bad. One paper had it down as Black Flag Violence. Funny how often that used to happen. We would do a show and things would be fine. The pigs would show up and start shit with the kids and then a riot would happen. They always blame the youth and punk rock for all of it. There was never a riot until the pigs came and started pushing people to the ground and threatening them. That's why I don't like pigs. I've seen what they do and there's no way any of them can tell me that we were the cause of the violence. After the show, we went back to the girls' place and called it a night. We were burning out at the girls' house in London. We got a call to play the 100 Club opening for a band called Krongen. It was a gig and we took it. We went and loaded in through the snow. We played 2 sets since there was no one else playing and no one seemed to notice our presence anyway. After we got off, Krongen played. A skinhead girl came up to me and kissed me on the cheek. I think I said something funny like, "Why shucks, ma'am, thank you very much," and thought nothing more of it. The next thing I knew, I was on the ground. Someone had punched me in the back of my head real hard. I got up wondering what fucking time zone I was in and I saw the guy who delivered the sucker punch. It was this big skinhead motherfucker who was rolling up his sleeves to show me his swastika tattoos. I didn't know what I had done to deserve this beating. I kind of stood there trying to get my balance back. A roadie from the UK subs came over and talked the piece of shit skinhead out of killing me. Charlie Harper of the subs got me out of there and took me to this room in the back. He told me that the guy used to be a bouncer there and got fired for breaking a chair over another bouncer's head. I felt like I got hit with a truck. I figured out that I had been set up by the skinhead girl. It was par for the course. That's the way these pieces of shit are. This was a shitty tour, and all the worst things in the world would come our way. Next stop, Wales. We drove the box truck up to Colwyn Bay, Wales. Most of us had to ride in the back of the truck with the equipment. We couldn't see out, and it was freezing back there, but that was the deal. It was not an assuring thought of Dukowski up front driving on the wrong side of the road. If any bad was to befall us, at least we would never see it coming. We load into this freezing hall that's above the water. The Nig Heist went on first. The Nig Heist was a band made up of Mugger, Black Flag types, and any road crew we could find. The evening's lineup included Ian on bass and Spot on guitar. I think Dez played drums. They played and people loved them and covered them with spit and beer. Poor Mugger. He just scored that nice sweater from good old Jimmy Percy and made the mistake of playing in it. By the time their short set was over, the sweater was covered with saliva and beer. I think he threw it out. So finally we get to play. We're having a great old time and the audience is cool and we're right in the middle of a song called Padded Cell and the song just kind of falls over. And I look to Greg to see what's going on and he's holding his head and there's blood streaming down his face. I ask him what the hell happened and he says he got hit with a bullet. Greg was shot? No. Someone threw a bullet at him and opened him up. I looked up right in time to see a pint mug smash against the wall over the drum riser. Time to leave. End of show. After that, we're sitting backstage wondering what the fuck we're gonna do. This kid named Fred comes backstage to talk to us. I ask him why someone threw the bullet at Greg. He said it was some skinheads that came to the show just to break it up. They didn't know who we were. All they knew was we were Americans and we had to be beaten up. We had no place to stay, of course, and Fred said that we could stay with him. We drove the truck up to his parents' place and find out it's a small house. Mugger quickly scams on the guy's sister. He's in. A few of the others quickly run in. There's no more room. I go out to the truck with Chuck. I try to go to sleep in the back of the truck with my trench coat as a blanket. At some point, I did fall asleep. I remember getting up in the morning and seeing frozen condensation drops on the ceiling of the truck, and Dukowski sleeping away in his sleeping bag that he had been smart enough to bring. He looked so peaceful and happy sleeping there that I wanted to slug him. Eventually we got up and left for Preston, England. So we get to Preston and find out that it's depressing and freezing. Hours later we're playing in this small freezing dump. The nightly skinhead confrontation happened. They came backstage and tried to fuck us up. I remember Dukowski knocking one of them hard with his bass and Ian dealing on one. I think I got in a couple of shots as well. They were thrown out by the security, a single black man with a heavy accent. We kept playing and finished the set. After the set, we had to stay inside because the skinheads were outside waiting for us. We figured that since we had no place to go, we might as well stay inside and let them freeze. I was hoping that they would be so stupid that they would stay out there and freeze to death and that would be the end of it. We hung out with this old man who was really drunk. He sang songs and we all sang along with him even though we didn't know any of the words. Finally, the skinheads left. But before they did, they ripped off the mirrors of the truck and kicked in the sides. Hey, it was a rental, who gives a fuck? A few days later, we were to drive to Leeds to play the Christmas on Earth festival. It was a ton of bands with the headliners being the Damned. We got there early and had nothing to do all day except hang out and watch the endless run of horrible bands. Ian and I got in a brief food fight with Captain Sensible. A lot of the bands were showing up without equipment. Stupidly, we were lending our rented gear to them. GBH used our stuff and later slagged us off in the press. The Any Nowhere lead used our stuff as well. Somewhere in there we got to play. The stagehands were yelling at us to hurry up. We got out there with no sound check, and the first note Chuck hits, he breaks his big string. Somehow we get it together when we play a set. I don't remember much except Ian coming on stage and saying, "Hey man, don't take the brown acid, man. It's a bummer, man. Hey, man, there's been a baby born out there. I think we're gonna name it Sid. Far out, man." A la Woodstock. I don't know how many of these stupid punkers got it, but we sure were laughing looking out at these 3,000 clones. We finished the last song and no one did anything. They didn't even hurl abuse. I swear I could hear leather jackets being zipped up all the way at the back. After our set was over, it was time for the punk rock star bands to play. The ones that you had traveled on a train from who the hell knows where and stood in piss and water hours to see. Vice Squad, the band fronted by Becky Bondage, played. They played their single two times. The band was pathetic. Chelsea went out there next, milking it for what it was worth. It was high comedy to listen to the ridiculous things that was coming out of the singer's mouth. This is the greatest thing since 77! Incredible. The UK subs, on the other hand, were great. They rocked the place. I didn't see how a crowd like that would be into something with that much energy. Before the Damned went on, I walked through the audience back towards the toilets. It was a mess. People passed out asleep in 3 inches of water. The men's room was trashed with a few inches of piss and water on the floor. It looked like a war zone. People were all over the place, all messed up. Puke everywhere. Punk rock! Excellent! The Damned played and were great. I knew they would be anyway. This is where the story gets good. The trunk rental company came and repossessed our truck from the parking lot. We were left with no way to get the rental gear back down to London. We were also supposed to be leaving the next day. We went from band to band asking for help. None of them would even talk to us. We didn't even think to ask the subs or the Damned. They were the headliners. As soon as they found out that we were stuck, they immediately came to our aid. The UK subs had their crew load our gear into their truck, and they said they'd even take it down to the rental place we rented the gear from and put it back. The Damned had a coach with a lot of extra seats, and they said we could all get on and ride back to London, no problem. Now how cool are these guys? So I'm walking onto the bus thinking that this is the coolest thing, to be riding in the bus with the Damned. I get on and the bus driver says it's full and he won't take any more people because it's the law. Mugger and I are left to get down to London on our own somehow with no money. Typical. We go to the train station and it's full of punkers waiting to get home. We meet up with some kid who has some passes or something. We scam on the train and get down to London. We get out of the train and we have just enough money to get a cab back to the girl's house. They weren't home and it's dawn and it's freezing, and so we said the hell with it and we broke into the damn place. We beat the rest of the guys back by hours. I'm in a great mood because we're going to be leaving and we're going to be going back to America. We get our gear together and hump it to the train and go out to the airport. We are, of course, too late and are denied access. We'll have to wait another day. So, we hump all the gear back to this girl's house, and at this point, the girls are getting pretty pissed off at us, but they're cool to us anyway. So we spend the rest of that day sitting around doing nothing in this cramped space. The next day, Ian gets up really early and says he's leaving to the airport. I say he's got hours to go before we leave. He says he's not going to miss the plane again, and off he goes. Hours later, we're out there again, running down the street with our luggage and assorted pieces of equipment. We get to the airport and check in. We get yelled at because we're so late. They have to hold up the flight several minutes for us. The entire flight is boarded. They didn't even bother to look at our passports. The lady at the gate was furious. I was so glad to be leaving, I didn't even care. I have never been so happy to be on an airplane in all of my life. I'll never forget walking to my seat with all these people giving us the eye because they knew full well that we were the reason that they had been sitting on the ground. I saw Ian grinning at me, shaking his head, pretending he didn't know who we were. Due to visa problems, Robo was detained in the UK. The show in Leeds ended up being Robo's last show ever with Black Flag. We flew to Dulles Airport near Washington. I spent the evening hanging out with some friends in town. I took a bath at this guy's house, first time I had bathed in several days. As I sunk under the water, a few hunks of spit reconstituted and floated to the surface. I decided that the next time I went back to England, I would handle myself and the audiences differently. December 23rd, New York City. We were in the shits because we had no drummer. We called Bill Stevenson from the Descendants and asked him to fly in and play with us. He knew all the songs well enough, so he came right out and the tour resumed. It was a great gig. The tension of seeing if we could pull it off only added to the excitement. Bill played great. We were happy to be back in the States with an audience that was into us, not trying to attack us and spit on us. It was a great homecoming. Christmas, Passaic, New Jersey. We were in New York hanging out. I think we were staying in the place on Avenue A where the Bad Brains had recorded their Roar sessions. The Necros were in town and told us they were going to Lodi, New Jersey to hang out with the Misfits. We went along to see the show. We ended up being the opening band. It was so cool. The Misfits were so great that night, so were the Necros. It was one of those nights that you know you're never going to forget. New York, the Peppermint Lounge. It was cool to play on the stage where I first saw Black Flag. They made us go on at some obscene hour in the morning. I remember when we loaded out, the sun was coming up. Chicago, Illinois. We played two sets with Husker Du. They were amazing, as you would expect. It was a good night. It was so cold outside when we loaded out after the show. Most of us were still wet from playing. The best was yet to come. We had a show in LA in less than 2 days. We hauled ass across the country, sometimes not even stopping to use the bathroom. You went right out the window. We would stop at gas stations and get food in small stores and then get back in the van and go. New Year's, Los Angeles. I don't know how we did it, but we did it. We pulled into the Olympic Auditorium in time for a late sound check. It was a wild show. The Blasters played before us. In my mind, they were a great band that not enough people ever found out about. Bill Bateman is one of the best drummers there is, and then, of course, there was the Alvin Brothers. A lot of talent for one band. I thought we played well. It was a great feeling to have gone all over the place and to have made it back. I felt more legitimate with a real tour under my belt. What I didn't know was the heavy shit was still yet to come. Hours after the gig, I was on the floor of SST trying to get to sleep. I was glad it was over, but when I found out that Bill had a Descendants gig up in San Francisco the next night, I remember feeling jealous that he was going to get to play and I wasn't. I was hooked. We came back to Los Angeles in late July and got ready to go out again in September. The tour was aborted in Canada due to the cartilage in my right knee falling apart. We had to drive home and I had to get surgery on my knee. 1983 was much better by comparison. February 5th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We picked up the Minutemen. 10 people in this van now. We're packed in like sardines. The drives are going to be hell, but that's okay. We get to play. Now at the East Side Club. What a dump. All these guys running around like they're in the mafia. Give me a break. I cut myself up with a piece of broken glass to get myself ready to play tonight. I don't know if anyone would understand that. Tomorrow we leave with the Minutemen for England. I hope the plane doesn't crash into the sea. To be free, you have to speak a different language. You have to think in another frame of mind. There's no hope in life. You get temporary breathers and that's it. Sometimes I need a dark room and stupidity to dull the pain. There's no such thing as friendship. You just get what you need when you need it as fast as you can. The only reason that people give is so they can take later on. I went walking, ended up in front of a 7-Eleven. I saw an old woman huddled in front. That'll be a tough one to deal with, a place to sleep without freezing to death. This is a cold place. No one lives here. They just die. People are disgusting. So tough, so mean, so scared. I can speak some of their language, but I can't translate it to save my life. I walked along the street and looked into the windows of all these bars, all the people inside staring off into space. What a lost place we're stuck in. February 7th, London. Landed okay. Now at some lady's house. I don't know who she is. I guess she's a friend of the promoter or something. Oh shit, some of the guys from the Anti-Nowhere League just came in. What a drag. Trapped in a cold, fucked up house with no money, no food, and these punk rock shitheads. I don't like touring with other bands, but I guess it's cool that the Minutemen are with us. Everyone should get a chance to see them. Their new record is finished, but it's not out yet. It's great. Tomorrow's practice and running. Thursday we hit it. We have to destroy them. If you want to destroy, you have to prepare. You have to practice. You have to learn your pain. The fact that there's a lot of people and almost no room on this tour is going to make it hard. The Minutemen have hardly been out the door, let alone on a Black Flag tour. We'll see how they hold up. You're not an American until you leave America. The people at this house aren't letting us forget where we're from for a second. I would rather be a human being than an American. Whatever. It's all over when we hit stage. Like Dukowski says, what the fuck? Fuck shit up. February 8th, London. Listened to Electric Ladyland with Dez today. The bitch of the house didn't like it, but hey, it was in her record collection. Practice was okay. We're going through rented equipment, so Greg is having a hard time of it. I think Dukowski never sounded better. The practice place is cold, fucked up, bad lights. It took us a long time to get here because we didn't know which side of the river the place was on and ended up crossing bridges for over an hour. I hate England. I knew this was coming. We're out of food and money. February 9th, London. It's 9 a.m. and everyone's asleep. I'm in the kitchen. Today will be a bad day. Long practice and little or no food. I'm used to this. This is the black flag thing. The only thing I want besides the chance to play is a meal and the chance to get some sleep. I think that deep inside we're all running from something. Thinking about the time I was in D.C. recently makes me see that. The lady from the Melody Maker magazine who interviewed me asked me why I'm so heavy. I'm heavy? I tried to explain the way I see things. I don't think it worked. I could tell by the way she looked at me. I walk through life with a heavy heart, a deep sorrow. It makes me go. A heavy stone. I would rather try and write it out than talk to anyone about it. There's nothing to say to anyone anyway. Maybe some girl I could talk to. My brain moves from meal to meal. That may seem pretty funny, but that's the way it is right now. I can't wait to be able to think of some other things and not have to be preoccupied with thoughts of where the next meal is coming from. It makes me mean. The bottom line is that we get to play. February 11th, Croydon, England. The show last night was cool. People showed up and everything. Did another interview in a pub near the 100 Club. It was for the NME. Now I'm in a room with a stereo. I'm playing Hendrix. Soon we leave for the boat. Tomorrow night we stay in a real hotel. Later. Now on the boat. This boat is huge. Saunas, a disco, a movie theater. I'm sitting far away from the others. Our roadie mugger is running around screaming, "Blowjobs! Blowjobs!" I don't want to be involved. He and the drummer are running around trying to meet girls by yelling at them. Somehow, I don't see it working all that well for those guys. This is a strange trip. One night, I'm in some grimy club, and the next night I'm in a boat that looks like the lobby of a hotel. I'm tired, but there's really no place to sleep except the floor, which is no big deal. It's where I always sleep. I don't want to get my stuff ripped off as I sleep. So if you steal this, send it back when you're done with it. Flash! Piercing screams from the upper deck, followed by rowdy American low-rent rock stars yelling to stay because, "There's a party up here!" Four young girls come tearing down the stairs and run past me. People on my deck gasp in disbelief. We haven't even left the dock yet. February 13th, the German-Dutch border. About last night, the Nigheist got through one song before skinheads jumped on stage and started attacking them. One asshole was swinging a mic stand at Mugger's head. It was fucked. The Minutemen were freaking out before they went on. They thought they were going to get killed. It just made me mad. I wanted to kill those fuckers. When we played, one skin got on stage and was looking off stage to show off to his friends, and I kicked him off and he fell a long way to the floor. He didn't dig that too much. 850 people showed up, but I bet there'll be a lot less next time. D. Boone had the best move of the night. During the song, Fanatics, D jumped off stage with his guitar on and ran through the crowd screaming, "Fanatics!" People didn't know what to do. He knocked those skinheads over like bowling pins. The countryside is beautiful. I've never seen anything like it. Thatched roofs on the houses, snow everywhere. The sky is so blue. I'm 22 years old today. February 14th, Hamburg, Germany. Played last night in Hanover. Real good. The place was small and packed. The air was mostly smoke, so it was hard to breathe. Played a 24-song set. We kept going off stage and Dukowski kept saying to play more. Fine with me. It was hard, though. Me and Bill kept grinning at each other because we knew how the other one was hating the heat. But we pulled it off, though. The gig here was at a place called the Markthalle. A lot of people. A lot of really fucked skinheads. Mike Watt got mugged at the bar when they heard his American accent. When we played, the skins were all up front telling us to go home and pushing people around. They kept swinging at my head when I got too close to the edge of the stage. Finally, I asked the crowd how many of them thought that the skins were assholes. The place cheered. The skins shrank back and just stared. I played hard. I poured myself out. I feel like a dry sponge. You can play until you drop and no one cares. There's a lot they'll never know. I don't want the things they tell me to want. I'm losing all hope for people. I don't feel like writing anymore. I hate everything and I'm lonely and I think that there's no way out. Destroyed by the eyes of the world. February 15th. On a day off in Hamburg. Didn't do much. Greg went off on the guys who were running the food store below the hotel. They're trying to rip us off, and I didn't think much of it because I expected these guys to be sleazy, but Greg was really pissed. He and Dukowski started eating food out of the refrigerator and yelling at the guys. The guys behind the counter knew that they were busted and had no choice but to let them do it. They looked at the rest of us and realized we would have beat the shit out of them. There's something about your eyes when you haven't eaten for a while and you've been fucked with by skinheads that says, don't fuck with me. February 17, Köln, Germany. It was a wild show. The guys at the door pulled a few knives and a gun off people coming in. When we were playing, I saw a guy about to club another guy with a piece of lead pipe. I grabbed it out of his hand as it was coming down towards his head. It was crazy. The press people and the hangers-on were treating me like I was some kind of star. Interviews are ego roller coaster rides. They're self-indulgent wastes of time unless they're informational. Some people feed on the star treatment. Later. Now at the club in Osnabrück. Cold in this place. Skinheads are here for some reason. It's not even soundcheck and they're here. I don't like the pressure of playing under the stare of some stupid army faction. Power is a dangerous thing. Organizations are evil. Unity is evil. Only a cowardly idiot would align himself with some unified faction. This shit can be hazardous to your health. The outsider presents a threat to the power of the uniform. If you can't convert the outsider, you must destroy the outsider. Maybe that's why the skinheads hate our guts. Later. The sound check is over with, went okay. The skinheads make me nervous. It's hard enough to play these gigs, let alone have to deal with these shitheads. There's always too many of them. I never see them alone. Tomorrow we leave to go to Berlin at 7:30 in the morning. Mike Watt never stops talking. Sometimes he makes me sick. It's not like there's any place I can go hang out in here. The room is small and we're all stuck in here and I think I'm gonna punch Watt's fucking lights out before this is all over. Fuck it. Maybe I should just go get a job in a library, live in a cave, I don't know. February 18th, Berlin. Hello. Here at the SO36 Club. Inside is cold. The heating is broken. It is painfully cold. Do you know the meaning of cold? If you haven't been to a cold place, then come on down to the cheery SO36 Club here in Berlin, just 5 minutes from the Berlin Wall. February 20th. Just crossed into Austria. The gig last night was good. About 1,100 people came. We played in a place called the Löwenbräu Keller, this huge beer hall. Before we went on, I was checking out the size of the beer mugs these people were drinking out of. They must have weighed a few pounds on their own, no lie. All I could think of was one crushing my skull. I wrote a postcard to a friend of mine and told him it might be the last gig I'll ever do, because you can't sing too well with a head full of glass. No one threw anything at us. They did wreck the barricades and scared the living shit out of the security, though. Before we went on, people were telling us about how Hitler had spoken on the same stage here many years ago. February 21st, somewhere. Last night in Vienna was real bad for me. A guy took the microphone from me, called me a pig, and bashed me in the mouth with it. People spat at me, hit me in the face. One guy burned me a few times with a cigar. I got these big burns on my leg. Some big guy got on stage and the bouncers were trying to hit him. So I got between them to try and save the guy, and for my trouble, the guy hauled off and punched me in the jaw. After that, it got wild. Police came in and the crowd beat the shit out of the cops, the police dog too. Some punks were wearing the pigs' hats. It was intense. During the Minutemen set, someone hit D. Boone with a trash can. It bounced off. February 22nd, Milan, Italy. The drive was long. We went through the Alps. The night came and we climbed and climbed. Our van had no snow tires and we were going through heavy snow. A few times I thought Dukowski was going to dump us off the side and down into hell. Mike Watt, of course, would not shut up. He's a one-man freakout. At one point, I thought Dukowski was going to pull over and punch him out. All the while, we had the Live King Crimson album on. The weather is warmer here. The poster for the show tonight is so great. It's a Pettibone drawing blown up real huge with our name underneath it. February 23rd at the Italian-Swiss border. The Italian border is on strike. They don't want to let the equipment van in. They threatened to beat up Devo. Last night was real cool. When we got to the club, there were all these kids there. We pulled up to the front door and they started rocking the van and pounding on the windows. I thought they wanted to kill us. I was getting ready to get out of there as best I could without getting hurt too bad. When we got out of the van, they all started hugging and kissing us and giving us presents. A lot of them had black flag logos painted on their jackets. They thought that the Minutemen were Husker Du. After that, a lot of people started coming to the place and wanted to get in for free. The owner went outside and told them, no way. The kids started throwing rocks at the club's windows and started fucking the place up. In the main office, they had a video camera set up and we watched the whole thing from inside. The police came and started kicking ass on the kids. A couple hours later, we got to play. It was wild, to say the least. So tonight, if we got out of Italy, we play Geneva, Switzerland. After tonight, we have a 3-day space out. The drive here was amazing. I've never seen castles like these before. I've seen some in England years ago, but they weren't like these. The Alps blow my mind. Everywhere you look, looks like a postcard. Tonight's crowd will be the basic German type, I bet. Too bad. We were spoiled in Italy, all those people being so nice to us and all. Now I guess it's back to the hostile shit. Devo has to drive back to the border to get some paperwork filled out that they wouldn't do the other day. What a waste of time. You should have seen these assholes, these fat pigs. One of them tried to buy Dukowski's watch. Later, at a hotel. We played real tight tonight. The toughest skinheads were total chicken shit. A guy threw a cup of piss on Dukowski as Dukowski was walking off stage. Dukowski went berserk, man. It was wild. He started wrecking the dressing room. I've never seen him act like that before. But I've never had a cup of piss thrown on me either. I gave it all I had, but it's hard to dig in all the way with a bunch of gluehead punks casually spitting on you. February 24th, Geneva, Switzerland. Hanging out in some punker squat. Tonight we'll stay here and then we'll go on to Denmark. The people in this shithole are gross. All they do is rip stuff off, get drunk, and listen to shitty punk rock. Dez had some fun with some of the punkers. He put in a ZZ Top tape into the community blaster. All the punkers started yelling at him. Dez told them that the tape was the new Exploited album. The punkers were stupid. They all believed him. One guy started crying. No shit. February 28th, Copenhagen, Denmark. I don't know who I am. I'm so tired. We left Hyde Park at 3 a.m. We've been traveling since then. We just got here. It's time for soundcheck. We have found a way to get Watt so pissed off that he might have a cardiac arrest. It's simple. We start telling him that his girlfriend is with some punker with a mohawk now that he's away from home. He always goes for it and gets mad and calls us all a bunch of motherfuckers. Another thing to do to pass the time is to get Watt and D. Boone in one of their epic arguments. It's easy. Set up any topic. Chances are that they already disagree. When one guy says something, anything, just say to the other, "Are you going to let him say that kind of shit to you? Don't take that shit from him, unless you're just scared of him. Well, I guess I see who really runs this band." After that, all you have to do is just get out of the way. Boone and Watt will go at it like Siamese fighting fish. We have been listening to Mike Watt's tapes because he gets so freaked out about who gets to play what and he starts talking about fascism when someone puts something in the deck. So, Mike has been put in charge of playing all the music just to shut him up. He's turned me on to some cool stuff. James Blood Ulmer, Albert Eiler, this really cool live Curtis Mayfield album, all kinds of shit. It's worth putting up with Watt because he's such a great bass player and the Minutemen are so amazing. It would be nice to be touched by hands that didn't want to kill me or congratulate me. Sometimes the hands that want to kill me are mine. March 5th, Croydon. Last night was pretty rocky. They were throwing plastic mugs at us. It was hard to sink into the music while dodging the projectiles. A man with a mohawk started to fuck with Greg. I beat him up. His mohawk made a good handle to hold onto when I beat his face into the floor. The bouncers were afraid to break it up. They stood nearby and asked me to please let the guy go. The punk rock shithead. It would be so cool if we could just kill these posers. Next time a guy fucks with Greg, I should let the guy just punch Greg's lights out. Sure would be better than having him call me a macho asshole. If that guy had slugged Greg instead of me getting him away from his face, he might have seen things a bit differently. That's just not part of what he sees. He just sees me hitting some guy. He doesn't see the part where it would have been him getting his ass kicked. I don't bother talking to him about it because you can't talk to Greg. You just take it and keep on playing, whatever. I don't enjoy playing unless I see blood or get hurt. I bet these people would think that's crazy. The world is cold and no one understands you anyway, so fuck it. I just called the girl that I go out with long distance. She told me she doesn't want to go out with me anymore and then she hung up. Fucking hung up on me long distance. I guess that when I get back home, I'll be alone again. March 10th, Brooklyn, New York. In a club called the Brooklyn Zoo. Last few days I spent in D.C. I had a good time. I hung out with Ian and went to a few record stores. Took the train up here on my own. I feel older than when I left D.C. I know I'm older in years, but I've seen a lot of shit since I've been in the band. I deal with people differently. It took me a while to get used to how differently they treat you. People that you thought were your friends give you shit about working hard. All I know is that we play hard, and a lot of this shit is not fun. Playing is great, but the way we live is not the life of a rock star. When people tell me that I'm a rock star, I tell them they can go get fucked. Like I said before, the world is cold and no one understands you. I never knew how alone you could get. Now I know a little more. March 17th, Chicago. Have not written in here for a few days. Fuck it. There's nothing to write about. The other night in New York, this poet guy, Allen Ginsberg, came to see us. I don't know what the guy's trip is. I've seen some of his books at my mom's house. I remember seeing a picture of him when I was very young. He said, "I moved like a kabuki dancer, the way I writhe and undulate." Whatever the hell that means. March 19th, Minneapolis, Minnesota. Played here last night. Real good time. Be back in LA soon. 10 more shows to go on this one. I'm pretty tired. I like playing, though. That part of the night always seems to go well, no matter how I'm feeling before. I can always play. The last trip to Europe was hard. Some of it was scary. It's hard to be in this band sometimes. It comes with the territory. I had a bad one in Chicago the other night. We were in the second set, and I was pulled off stage and thrown to the floor by the audience. Most of my pants were torn off, and people started kicking me. I remember feeling the glass that was on the floor going into my back. Dukowski pulled me back on stage, and then I kind of freaked out during the next song. Dukowski carried me off stage, and that was the end of the show. I sat on the stairs and shook for about 20 minutes. No one said shit about the fact that we left off a few songs from the set. It was weird. Maybe I'm too worn out right now. All I remember is I lost control of myself. March 20th, Denver, Colorado. Sitting in the lobby of the Rainbow, the place we're playing. A lady that does shows here looked at the infected cigar burns on my leg and asked me if I was on heroin. It was a hell of a drive to get here. It's cold and my throat is swollen. I'm more exhausted than I have ever been. I feel pretty freaked out. I'm still thinking about that night in Chicago. That was scary. Tonight is the last show of this tour. I don't know what we'll do when we get back. If we're not on tour, life just slows down. When we're out, it's hard. Whenever we get back, all I can think about is how great it was being out there and when we get to leave again. The rest of 1983 was spent doing sporadic shows on the West Coast and dealing with our legal problems. Later in the year, our bass player Chuck Dukowski left. He was replaced by a woman named Kira Rossler. The rest of the year was spent recording the My War album and practicing with Kira, getting ready for their album release and a full-scale assault on the world in 1984. Also around this time, I moved into an empty tool shed in the back of the Ginn's yard. I had the coolest place to live out of anyone in Black Flag. It was tiny, cramped, full of potato bugs and spiders, rotting books, mildew and cobwebs, but to me it was home. I spent periods of time in there for the next 2 years writing and hanging out.